Ladies and gentlemen, I welcome everyone tonight. I first want to say thank you so much for the students for coming twice in 1 week. I know that that's a commitment and there are other things that you might have had to put on hold for tonight, so thank you so much. And I'm very, very happy to have our guest here tonight. I'm Bob, thank you for being here. And so what we're going to do is sort of follow our agendas that you have, but I want to remind you that at any time that you have a burning question or anything that you want to ask one of our speakers, I think they're more excited about hearing from you, so please feel free to do that. But there will be also some formal places where we can do this. Jennifer, hi.
Hi.
Got your name tag? Okay, great. So the purpose of our meeting tonight is really twofold. One is that we wanted the students to have an opportunity with people who have experience with their own businesses and endeavors to hear your story and perhaps some, should we say the word advice or just insights into those things. And secondly, to let you know what they're up to and give them a chance to talk a little bit about what they will be doing in a much larger way in about 3 weeks. So I hope when they talk about their businesses that you will have at least one question that you can ask them that might help them, because when they go in front of the investment panel, they're going to have a lot of questions for them. So how's that sound? Does that sound good to everyone?
Yes.
Before we start, I do want to make sure I say my thank yous. We do want to make sure we see Dr. Cynthia Herrera or anyone from Oxnard College that we say thank you, because they organized this building for us to meet in every time we meet, and refreshments and all kinds of wonderful things. We also want to remember that YEA is sponsored by the Oxnard Chamber of Commerce, and all three of these gentlemen have a relationship with the Chamber, so afterwards you might want to just thank them for that support we get. We thank the Chamber for their vision and their commitment to the success of young people like all of you in this room who live in our community, and we salute your generous spirit and creating a positive environment for the entrepreneurial enterprises and innovation that we believe these students are going to contribute. So thank you so very much. So I thought if it would be all right with you gentlemen, we could start and just have our young entrepreneurs stand up, not talk about your businesses right now, but just simply stand up, say what your first and last name is, what your grade in school is, where you go to school, and perhaps you could share, if you know what you want to do when you graduate, you could share some, just one thing about yourself. Would you like to do that? Okay, who would like to start?
Can we stand up there?
Oh, yes, yeah. You want him to stand up?
That would be, okay. That would be much nicer,
okay.
Yeah.
We're recording this, so
yeah.
Okay, would you like to come up and introduce yourself? Thank you.
No, no, come right over here. Stand up. Nice and loudly, you know, like you've been taught.
Okay, good evening. My name is Agnes Albert, and I'm a junior at Chatham High School.
And tell us a little bit about yourself,
Angela. Oh, and I want to major in accounting and finance.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're always good.
Good evening, my name is Celeste Rivera, and I'm a junior at Chatham High School, and I have to tell you that I'm the president of the junior class of the Business Academy.
Excellent, thank you.
Ready? Hello, my name is Diana Rama. I'm a junior at Chatham High School, and I'm the vice president of the Business and Finance Academy. And when I graduate, I want to major in possibly marketing and social media studies.
Hi, my name is Sissam Sunia, and I am a junior at Chatham Islands High School. And I am in the Business and Finance Academy. And one thing I want to do after I graduate is probably do culinary arts or social work.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Bianca Montes. I'm a junior at Chatham Islands High School. I am the secretary of the Business Academy, and when I graduate, I want to study so I can become a social worker.
Hi,
Tintin, and I am in 7th grade in Fremont Middle School. And one good thing about me is that I am a chef.
Hi, my name is Carmen Gonzalez, and I'm a 6th grader who belongs to RJ Fifth Middle School, and I love playing sports. Thank you.
My name is Mark Charney. I am a lawyer. I've been practicing in Oxnard since 1967, so I've been here a couple of days. And my field of specialty is land development and real estate transactions. Personal interests, I own a horse. It's for sale. Anybody want a horse? I've got 5 children and 9 grandchildren, and that's a big, heavy interest.
Yes,
sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, good evening. It's nice to be here. My name is Mel Sheeler, and I was born and raised here in Ventura County. My mother was born here in Oxnard, and my grandfather had a grocery store down on Fifth Street in 1907.
Wow.
So got firm roots within the community. My career has really been very varied, if you will. I have changed my occupation and profession several times throughout my career, and that's one of the things that I'll talk to you about being prepared to make changes in what you're doing and in your focus. Married, have 2 children, both of them married, living in Camarillo. Have 3 grandchildren, went fishing with them yesterday, so time off, and my profession, I had Sheeler Moving and Storage and Sheeler Document Management in Ventura for the past 14 years.
My name is Tom Wandel. I'm one of your local Good Neighbor State Farm agents. And I grew up in a little town called Torrance. And it's not such a little town anymore, but it was very similar to Oxnard. So when we moved here in Oxnard in 1989, it reminded me a lot of when I was growing up as a kid. So I've always felt very at home in Oxnard, Ventura County, because that's what it was like when I was a kid growing up. I've been a State Farm agent for 42 years, if I didn't mention that. So I've been doing it a while. What you find in with the other gentlemen is that you experience a lot of change. Just those kind of changes, it's the adaptability and ability to change with the marketplace and with your business. So. We'll be talking some more about that. I'm married. I've been married to Gail. We have 7 kids and 5 grandchildren and 1 on the way.
Congratulations. So, ladies and gentlemen, what we'd like to do is maybe find out a little bit about your experiences throughout your business professional life. And again, if you would like to ask a question that I've missed or at any time, you know you can raise your hand and I will make sure that we have plenty of time for that. So you can take your turns or however you want to do this, but we really would like to know when you were the age of our students, what were you doing? Were you thinking about business? Or are you out there playing ball? Or, you know, what were your experiences?
I think the short answer is, who can remember that? I wasn't. I'll tell you what I wasn't doing. I was not thinking about starting my own business and being an entrepreneur. And I'm really thrilled and congratulate all of you for doing that now. When I was between 11 and 18 years old, I think is the age range in here, I knew that I would have to work for a living. There was no fortune waiting for me anywhere. And I, as most kids who are any good at all with math and science, was kind of pushed by the school system into engineering, because this was the days of the space race, and we were losing it. The United States was losing it. So I was studying math, I was studying chemistry, I was studying the high school physics, and preparing myself for college, because that, in my mind, in those days, was the stepping stone towards success.
I too can't remember that far back, but I do remember I was certainly not preparing myself to go into business for myself. But one thing that I did know, and I learned from an early age, from my dad, who never once told me that he had to go to work, and you hear that a lot, too, I have to go to work tomorrow, I have to work on Friday. My dad always said, you get to go to work. You never have to, but you get to. My dad worked his entire career in the oil patch, and that led me to an opportunity to do some of that work during the summer and during Christmas and Easter breaks. I never got to, I didn't go to Cancun, I didn't go to Hawaii, I worked every single break. But one thing that it did teach me is that I needed to get an education, because I did not want to have to do the type of work that my dad had to do and did. He did gratefully, but it's very physically demanding. I saw the wear and tear on him. I saw the hours that he had to work. And I knew that I had to get an education so I didn't have to follow in his footsteps as far as the type of work that he was doing. I can tell you that when I was your age, I was already involved in Boy Scouting. I was involved in Little League. At Ventura High, where I was my alma mater, I'd already joined the Key Club there, which is a national service organization tied to Kiwanis International. So I was in a position to already start giving back. And if you're not in that mode now, that is one of the things that I would strongly encourage you to do, because that is going to be a tremendous help to you as you go out and develop your relationships in life. And part of that is to giving back and creating those relationships. And you're going to develop and get to know some of the best friends you have in your life through those relationships. And I strongly commend you for being where you are right now. It's hard to believe that young people like at your ages are already thinking about a business that they want to go into. So that's congratulations.
Let's see. At your age, I was playing baseball, football, basketball, studying. I always attained good grades. Can't stress that enough. It's important to do well in school. It will reflect later on in your life with the ability to complete things. You don't just start them, you complete them. And you don't just complete them, you complete them and you do a good job on them. So that's really where that reflects. As far as key clubs or things like that, I was always in honor society and that sort of thing through high school. But my bent was mathematics. In chemistry, and that's what I started. That's why I have a degree in chemistry. So and I sell insurance, so you go figure that one out. So if you have an idea that you're going to end up in business someday, I mean, my advice to young people today is to consider that as an avenue for a degree, because it's going to teach you a whole lot more about dealing with people instead of test tubes and chemicals and things like that. You know, even though that was a lot of fun, I enjoyed that. Listening to Mark and Mel, we all knew we were going to have to work when we got out in the real world, and it's there's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. You know, nobody's going to take care of you. You've got to take care of yourself and your family and the people around you. So, if I have any piece of advice when it comes to an area of interest, do something that you're passionate about and that you enjoy going there. And you know, otherwise it's not going to be a lot of fun. I'll tell you right now, I meet a lot of people, and the ones who really are the most successful are the ones who really enjoy what they do and who their customer is, and that's really what it's about. You'll find that as through our professional lives is that we probably, it's not about getting, it's about giving. And so, if you have that kind of a mindset, I think you're going to have a great life.
Thank you.
I'm going to skip around these questions a bit, but can you tell us what you really enjoy, speaking of enjoying what you do, what do you like about your role as CEO, business owner, managers, or the endeavors that you've chosen? What is it that you just, every day think, wow, I really like what I'm doing. What is that one thing that means something to you?
Let me start.
You may.
Okay. For me, it's helping people get to another level in their life. And so you don't become just a business owner. You wear a lot of different hats. So you're the human resources director. You're the sales coach. You're the shoulder to cry on when something bad happens. You're the claims person in my business. We just do a lot of different things. But the one thing that I get, I have a joy of, I had a young lady, I'll just share this with you to kind of give you an idea of what I do. So I had Selena come to me right out of high school. She was 19 years old. And this was several years ago. She came out of Santa Paula High School, and she was working and going to school. And I was, somehow she came to my office and was a receptionist. And as time went on, she grew in the business and really enjoyed what she was doing. Ultimately, today she's an agent venture. So she went all the way, she went to Long Beach State, got her degree, came back, mentored her some more, got her hooked up with, and she decided to be an agent. So nothing, it's like I'm her State Farm dad, you know, not really, but I look at her as one of my children. And Sophie, instead of 7 times 8, the other ones in my office you care a lot about, and you want to see them advance and do well in life. And you're there for them to help them, mentor them, talk to them, help them through issues, because life has issues. And so they can get, maybe have some success and some enjoyment in their life. That's pretty much it. Any questions?
I think we're
going to
come back to some of those things as well. Mel, what
do
you got to tell us? What is it that you deeply enjoy about your role?
You know, I think a lot of what Tom had to say has, people that are in business feel pretty much the same way. It's giving opportunity to others. I always tell everybody that in the moving and storage business, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to be an employee, but to be an employee, you must be somebody that can communicate, has drive, initiative, can take direction, is willing to help the customer, which is predominant. And being in business for yourself gives you an opportunity to bring people forward. And I've always told all of my staff, I hope that through a couple of years working in this business and you see how physically demanding it is, it'll give you the incentive that you want to take and do something different in your life. And I'm just providing those initial teaching lessons to you, if you will. And had a lot of success with that. But by the same token, I had individuals who stayed with me for over 25 years. Could have gone to other companies, could have sought out different career paths, but because of the relationship that we established, they chose to continue working, you know, with me. And I think that's one of the things you have to remember. Staff does not work for you, but they work with you. If they don't work with you, those relationships are never going to reach the full fulfillment. And your business, whatever you're doing, is not going to be successful. If you treat them as just employees, they are working with you to help you also become successful. And if I can give any advice, that is probably the main advice that I would give. Getting involved with your customer, getting to know them, to where whatever their needs are, they come to you. And it may not even be something that your business is directly related to, but if they have enough confidence in you, they will give you a call and say, hey, I'm thinking of doing this, or I need this service. Who can you recommend to me? And when you develop clientele like that, they call you first so you can help them and direct them. Then you really know that you've done really the best job for your client. And then that's creating that relationship. So that's really where I'm coming from. And thank you very much.
Well, finally, I spent most of my career in a partnership. I was the eighth lawyer to join the firm back in 1967. And it grew to be a partnership with about 40 lawyers at the largest point. And with associate lawyers, with paralegals, with secretaries, with messengers, with file clerks, with receptionists, IT personnel. We had about 100 employees altogether. So it became a big firm. And I had the privilege and the opportunity to serve both as the managing partner of the firm and as a member of the management committee of the firm for many years. It was a challenge. Managing that many people, and when you're in a partnership, nobody really has a final say. No one person does. Eventually, everything comes down to a majority vote, if it takes that. So managing those relationships, I think, was one of the most enjoyable things that I did as both a managing partner, as a member of the management committee. Getting 18 or 19 very independent, strong-minded people to come to a consensus about how things ought to be done, what technology changes we ought to adopt, how many hires we needed, what cases we should take. It was the ability to affect that the way I thought it should be affected. I think that was one of the things that I enjoyed most in my role as a manager, owner of that partnership. That partnership closed about 3 years after I was bought out. We had a mandatory buyout at a certain age. And that partnership closed, and about 2 years ago, I opened my own sole practitioner's office. So for the last 2 years almost, I've been working solo with one employee who's the secretary who worked for me for 15 years before. And I enjoy that a lot too. And I enjoy the fact that I am now completely the manager of my own destiny. The clients that I have worked with for 30 or 40 years are still my clients for the most part. As both Tom and Mel said about the relationships, that's very important to establish lasting relationships. I still maintain good relationships with many of my former partners. I was partners with some of these people for over 40 years. And we can still make referrals back and forth, those who are still practicing. So relationships are very important, and the ability to affect where your business is going and how it's operating and what it's doing is an extremely rewarding part of being your the owner of your own business or the chief executive officer of your own business.
There's a common thread with all three of you where people, either developing people or developing people to develop the business, have been very satisfying and rewarding, and certainly takes a lot of skill. I think we built over a period of time to do that. I'd like to stop just for a moment because we do have three new people walking in, and in our little group, people are everything. So if I could have Joey and Jordan, each one of you, could you just come up and stand up, and all you've done is, would you introduce yourself, tell us your first and last name, where you go to school, what grade you're in, and just one thing about yourself. Can you come over and do that for us? And we're so happy to see you. I think Bob wants us to stand right here.
My biggest failure was getting involved with an attorney. And it was definitely not Mark. Had it been Mark, I wouldn't have had the problem that I did. But I was introduced to an individual through a gentleman that I worked for, as a matter of fact. And he approached me with a business idea. And it was to go into the restaurant and grocery business up in Ojai. That's where I lived and actually grew up in the Ojai Valley. And I sort of believed everything that he told me, if you will. I believed in the documents that he provided me. Sounded like a tremendous idea, something that I could do. And I was not afraid of the risk. And I had the money and the capital to be able to, you know, to make this change in careers. Only to find out that what he had provided to me was false documents, false tax returns, false sales tax reports, things of that nature. And it ended up being a very, very costly mistake for me. The money that I had was quickly dissipated, and it almost took me under, but I had had grown up with the concept that, you know, when you sign a bank loan, it's always a promise to pay, and it's not a promise to pay if certain things happen, but it's a promise to pay, and I was able to pay those obligations. But I think the point that I'm trying to make is that through your career, you're going to get involved with different individuals. You need to do much more and greater research than what I did on the individual that you're going to become involved with. And that could be a business associate, a partner, somebody who's giving you advice. Do more and better research than I did. Had I done that, I would have definitely not made the mistake that I did. And that was the biggest failure that I've had. And I blame myself for that because I should have been much smarter than what I showed myself to be. So do your research, know who you're going to get involved in, and making sure that the decisions that you're going to make are decisions that you can stand behind. Interesting. you know, we all kind of share the same type of things. It may not be the same scenario, but they're similar. I put down, what was your biggest failure? Learning to be a business owner. I don't think I learned how to be a business owner probably until I was, you know, about 10 years as an agent, having my own business. Because you have to go through a lot of trial and error. You have to, you know, you don't go to school and learn how to run a business. That's why I think if you have an opportunity, you're thinking of being a business, get a business degree and sort of have an idea, and maybe go and apprentice that business for a couple of years or pick out somebody that's respected in the community. Go to the Chamber of Commerce, we'll give you a referral. And sit with those people and find out, you know, what makes them tick. But it's perseverance, it's hanging in there, and it's doing, and it's learning. You have to basically, you get through college and you start a career, and then you really learn about it. And that's when the road hits the road. So if you can get as much information before you go into it, I can't tell you. But we've all made bad decisions. That's how you learn how to make good decisions. And I have to remind myself of that. Do we do everything right today? No. You know, but we do more things right than we did several years ago. But it's if your heart's in the right place. It's hard not to trust other people. So I feel for Mel because we've all been down that road a little bit. But you want to trust people and you want them to trust you. So your word is your bond. And if there's anything I think that's so that you know, my biggest failure is also my biggest success. So once I learn how to be a business owner and make things work. And it's about doing the little things and doing what you need to do to get to the next level. That's pretty much it.
Do you have a question? I have one last question, but what questions would you like to ask our visitors about their successful and long careers that might be helpful to you in what you're doing, or you just have curiosity?
Have you found another attorney to work with, or did you just give up on them completely?
Did you find another attorney to work with, or did you stick with the same guy? Definitely. I really didn't have a business client relationship with that attorney at all. And, you know, had I done so, it would have been much more difficult for him to do what he ended up doing to me. It is one of those bad apples, and believe me, there are bad apples in every single profession. And you'll see those, you know, throughout your careers. And had it been Mark, he would have never led me in that direction. And believe me, there's some great people out there that you can turn to. And just be careful.
How about another question? Let's get a couple more questions. a law question that you might have, Jennifer. I should tell you that Jennifer she's actually working, but was an intern in a law office.
Can I ask a question?
You bet. Uh-huh.
Given the experiences that you've had with a completely different world than these youngsters are starting to face now, what would be the suggestion that you would give to them based on your knowledge of what you've learned over these years of being in business?
I think the advantage that people have nowadays is they are more used to change and more adaptable at dealing with change. You know, in the 1950s, when I was a kid, things didn't change the way they do now. New products, new ideas for doing business, those things just weren't coming out every other day as they are nowadays. So I guess the advice that I would give is that you just make yourself as adaptable and comfortable with the idea of change as you possibly can, because inevitably, you are going to see changes, lots of changes, and the person who can manage change, deal with change, and make that work for his or her own best interest is the person who's going to do the best of us in this world.
That's an excellent point.
Yes, I just wanted to get all your input on this idea. I am an employer, and hopefully all of you will eventually, you know, reach your desire of an employer. Sometimes you're in the position when you're hiring people, you'll read all these resumes, and you don't really know what you get until you get it. I mean, some resumes are right on target. You get the person, they come on board, and some are just like, wow, is this the same person? So I just want to know your experience about that, because I don't know if that's a bad approach, but I after going through it so many times and having so many different people, I just begin to think, just never know what you get to get it.
We're all employers. We've all employed people, a lot of people over the years. And when you're going through resumes, in fact, there's two things. Number one, have recommended sources and call those sources, call those people. Why would you recommend this person? Do you think this person would fit in this? You know, just you have to fit your questions within the law on that. But, and it's really hard to know, because sometimes it's a Jekyll and Hyde type thing. You know, you can put everything you want on paper, but if you don't do your due diligence again as an employer and take the time to do that, we do. In our business, there's a lot of compliance issues, as well as the other ones too. But we background checks, FBI reports, there's all kinds of things. So there's a lot of hoops that people have to jump through. These are things that are readily available to employers. And it just gives you an idea how these people conduct their lives. And some of them don't come back real faithful. So, and it kind of gives you just a heads up. There's also different tests out there for not so much aptitude type tests, but more a personality type test. Are you trying to put, you don't want to put a square peg into a round hole or try to cram that in there. So maybe one person's good for a certain type of job and another one's good for another type of job. So some of us have more of an aptitude maybe for selling. Some people have an aptitude for caring. Some people have an aptitude for service and just taking care of, like an administrative assistant, something like that. So those types of things are to have at your fingertips really can help you get past some of that. But as an employer,
live television.
As an employer, it's going to be your number one challenge throughout your career. Number one.
Uh, Tom, those are excellent comments. Now that the duck is flying.
You try to tell him his time is up.
You know, as you're looking, you know, as a business owner, you're going to be, you know, hiring individuals. First impressions play a very, very key and important role in whether you're going to have interview number 2, 3, or 4 with someone. And I think whatever you indicated, you want to look at the restaurant business. And, okay. That individual that you want to hire to help work in the kitchen, when he shows up, what is the appearance? Are his hands and fingernails clean? How does he keep his hair? Extremely important. Somebody that comes to you that is well manicured and looks professional, that's somebody that you perhaps want to take and go into the interview process a little bit deeper with. But that individual that comes in looking like he just came off of the street corner, and you're going, do I want him in my kitchen, serving my clients, helping me build my reputation or tear it down? You got to pay very, very close attention, you know, to that. And I mentioned earlier communication. So often now young people, and I put all of us in that category except for the three of us up here, don't know how to really communicate anymore. They're relying too much on technology and cell phones and iPads to be able to communicate with their friends and business associates and their clientele. You need to be able to open up and communicate verbally with them. Don't do it via the fax. Don't do it with a text. Talk to them. Because it's only through that two-way communication can you really get a better understanding of where both of you are coming from. So I think that communication is really a key to your eventual success in the business that you have.
I didn't like that hair crack. ditto on the due diligence and ditto on the appearance. So both of those things are very important. First appearances. When you're hiring lawyers, you have a lot of information available to you. First of all, what people learn in law school basically is how to be a good researcher, how to write, at least write in legalese, and how to prepare a resume. And you can look at their law school records, you can look at what they've done. They've got 3 years of law school and 4 years of college that you can look back at. So you've got some idea as to who the person is that you're hiring. At least you know how well they did in school and how much they were involved in organizations. So the important part there is just trying to evaluate the person. And that's, of course, always the toughest. It's very important to have personal face-to-face interviews in some depth. Talk to the person, try to get to know the person. Don't just ask questions, but have them ask you questions so you understand what they think is important. When you're dealing with non-lawyers, you don't have those formal kinds of records generally. It's a lot harder to just rely on a resume. And there are a lot of legal restrictions on getting even their work experience. So again, the evaluation of the person becomes really very important. One of the practical things is almost everybody's hired on some sort of a contingency basis. You have a 90-day period within which to evaluate them. And that is very important. Because no matter how good a job you think you've done on screening, you're bound to hire somebody who just doesn't fit in for one reason or another. Just doesn't mesh with what the job is supposed to be. And that person understands, and you understand, that first 90 days is for just to determine whether you like us and we like you. And during that 90 days, if it doesn't work out, they can leave, or we can ask them. So a very, very important part of practical part of actually hiring employees in a business. I think that's all.
Thank you. One more thing for that. What I do also is I bring my other team members in, and I have that person sit with us in a group setting, and then I'll have them sit with them in an individual setting in their own individual office. And so they can show, this is what I do, this is what I'm expecting, and this is what I'm in charge of. And let each one go through it, because, you know, I get more valuable feedback from my own team members than I do. I don't have to just rely on me.
I think that was an excellent question. Thank you for the feedback. I heard a long time ago that if you're a person that 40% of the time can hire people that fulfill their mission and they show up and they do more than you think, then you're probably better than the average employer. And I'm wondering if, and this I hear this a lot with people who do have to hire in all kinds of environments, and I'm wondering if part of the college experience should be not just learning how to do interviews, but how to interview and hire people. Because we do spend a lot of money in our culture with bad hires, both legally and otherwise. So I think it is something, as all of you become business owners, it may be one of your biggest challenges, I think. So that was an excellent question. Thank you. I have one more question, but then after that, I'd love our students to have a chance to present to you and then maybe have a little looser question and answer for a few minutes. We would love to hear, if you're willing to do it, to tell us when was a moment when you had a great success and you were very proud of yourself for your endeavor, your business. Would you be willing to share a high point in your career?
That's what we call aha moments. Uh-huh. We also have a ship's bell in our office, and when something really neat happens, we ring the bell. So just have fun. Probably in my business, there's a mark of attaining, if you will, a more accomplished level. And I think it was the first time that I qualified for what we call a millionaire trip. In other words, there's a certain amount of production all the way through the board. And we went to Montreal. And it was a week-long thing to Montreal and Quebec, Canada. And all expenses paid, first class all the way. I felt like that was my, so when I did that, and every time I do that since then, that those kind of things in my industry really are, I mean, it's really cool. And my family likes it. Everybody, it's a win-win-win all the way around.
How about you, Mel?
Yeah, I think that the highlight for me was being able to start my own business. And I started at a much older age than any of you here. But it was starting that business in a very short period of time, having that business become one of the most successful moving and storage and document management companies in all of Ontario. And we were able to accomplish that in less than 5 years. And you know, when you look back at companies that have been in business for, you know, 30, 40, 50, 100 years, to be able to accomplish something like that in such a short period of time and be acknowledged by the community for those successes was probably one of my crowning achievements. And getting named the Citizen of the Year for the city of Ventura, where I was born and raised, ranks right up there at the top as well.
Mark?
Well, good question. Right now, I think, other than my family, that's a big success. But other than my family, success in business, I'm getting a lot of satisfaction out of my new business. After, you know, 40-some years in a firm, to be able to open up and step out and take a lot of clients who have worked for a few years and continue to work for them, that gives me a lot of satisfaction, and I regard that as a big success. From a recognition standpoint, the Ventura County Bar Association selects a member every year who has made outstanding contributions to the community, community service. It's called the Ben Norton Public Service Award. And from settling the sense of personal recognition, getting that reward a few years ago was certainly the biggest thrill of the Redettos. Well appreciated, by me at least, recognition. So I think those are sort of some of the big successes that I've had.
So a lot of hard work goes into those successes that you've all talked about. And I think when you get rewards and other people in the community see your hard work, I think it must be very satisfying. So congratulations. Well, speaking of being proud, we are so proud at the Chamber, aren't we, Bob? Of all of these young entrepreneurs. They are amazing. They're interesting people in and of themselves. So we'd like to give them an opportunity to share a little bit about their businesses. And I'm trying to think of the most efficient way, Bob, to have them start. But we'll have them stand here. And if you have a partnership in your business, please, the two of you come up. And why don't I mix this up a little and start from this end of the room? So could we have the cousins come up first? And you can stand right here.
Now, Susan, if you could ask them, I have a little difficulty hearing.
Oh, yes,
and
thank you.
And if they could speak a little more clearly, and I can totally understand the,
excellent.
You know, where they're coming from.
And that's just a good practice for us. So we get very excited, and you know I do this as well. We are going to try to slow down our voices a little bit and talk clearly. And we don't have to go fast tonight. We can do this in a leisurely way. So.
Good evening. I'm Carmen Gonzalez. I am Shamara Bettis.
We're both
co-CEOs of Perfect Hattie. And basically, well, our product is an innovative shoe with logistical heel and pump, along with a stylish handbag for the other heels.
Well, I'll say it this way. Have your wives ever started complaining to you about a heel that they wanted, but let's face it, they cannot walk in it for the life of them, or they just wanted it a little bit taller? Well, with our product, it allows women to pick the certain height that they want that's comfortable for them and perfect for certain occasions. Plus, you still get the same style that's shaped for you, and it's great for them.
Well, now that you've heard about our product, how could you not want it? the woman in your life would like it. So how could you not want a product?
So
perfect.
May I ask a question? Yes. So is this a heel that fits on? You buy a shoe in the store, and then this is a heel that you can put on that shoe to adjust. Is that?
No, what our product is you go online onto our website and you buy our heels. Our style is a stiletto heel.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is you can pick out whatever style you want, color, anything. And as it's shipped to you, it comes with on and off heels and the pump, it comes with those too. So, because for some women, they like the heel long but the pump small.
Mm-hmm.
Or they like the pump heats, like they want this piece smaller. It will adjust to them, to their comfort, or a certain occasion. We're gonna try to make it so that you can just go and buy a heel from the store and change it. Although that would probably be a little bit harder considering the engineering of it.
Do you already have a website that you're using, or is this a concept that you're
How would you manufacture these?
What we're hoping to do is possibly, if we were not able to manufacture these, we're going to get a patent on it.
Mm-hmm.
So we would be able to sell the idea and the model of it to other shoe stores. So basically, they do all the work, we can be lazy.
Excellent. Well, thank you.
You can probably get some funding for that.
Thank you. would you like to go next, please?
Good evening, my name is Jonathan Mortman and I am the CEO of Future Attorneys Learning Law. My business is a student support center for high school students interested in a career in law. My business will help students understand the different types of laws they can practice and also give them an idea as to how the steps it takes to become an attorney, such as applying to college, applying to law school, and preparing for the exams such as the LSAT and the bar. With my business, we will also give students opportunities to meet with lawyers in the community and have internship opportunities.
Thank you. Interesting question.
Yes.
Where does your funding come from?
Investors, and I'm hoping to go to colleges and see their alumni that are now lawyers and try to get their support as well.
I just can ask, is do you have family members that are in the law profession?
Just one.
And are they mentoring you along the
No, I don't speak to them very often.
Sure, about your internship in the law firm that you work for.
I interned over the summer at Shiners & Associates, and I'm currently working there as an administrative assistant.
And that hasn't convinced you that you don't want to be a lawyer.
No,
I love it. You know, I like your idea because many college students who are in their junior and senior years and who find themselves going towards law school don't know anything at all about the practice of law or why they want to. And I can speak from personal experience. And I was one of those people. I didn't know anything about the practice. I didn't even know a lawyer before I went to law school. I basically went to law school to keep my options open. And it turned out that it was a great move. I had an extremely good professional life as a result of it, but I didn't know I was good. And I think that it would be very helpful to start at a lower level high school early college level to guide people towards it, and probably guide a lot of people away from it too. Eventually, you know, in many law schools, half the school drops out before they graduate. Then most of those people probably shouldn't have been there in the first place, not because they don't have the mental ability, but because they really just don't like it. And if they'd known that in advance, they wouldn't have wasted the money and the time that they wasted going. So I think it's excellent. Yeah.
Thank you.
This could be any type of metal, or it could be the flip. And we have stair railings and many other products for your home. And what the advantage I have to other ironwork companies is that I have a shop, so we can increase production, lower cost. And what I'm hoping to do is open a website, so we could, from anywhere in the US, they can order our product, and we could sell as many products as we want in one day. Thank you.
Shopify?
Oh, yeah.
Where'd you go for
your check? This is our product. It's made of two types of metals, as you can see here. It's bronze, as these two for the table. And on top is iron. Shit, it's outlined as a blaze knife. And its main purpose is for hot pants. Pots and
like
pants.
A proof.
Yeah. Thank you.
Awesome.
How did you cut out the design? Were you using a plasma cutter?
Yeah, it was plasma.
Yeah.
And I just welded it and I had to polish it. I'm still trying to wake up because I'm trying to polish it.
You did that?
My dad cut out the ink because I can't use plasma. I welded it.
Yeah. Understood.
have you developed costs for your products yet?
Yeah.
If you were to produce that particular item,
do you want to know what cost?
Raw materials and production costs are going to be. And
yes.
So what would it cost you to make that?
Can I get my notebook?
Sure, go right ahead. We've been studying cost analysis. So I just thought you might want to fill the heft of that. It's a piece of artwork as well as material.
The total price is $410 because the material cost, steel is $35 and bronze is $60. So total material cost is $95. Labors is 4 hours of labor, so 25 per hour. That's how much it would cost an employee to produce it. So that's $100. The overhead is $35. Manufacturing total is $2,230. And we have a 75% profit, so it would be $180. So the total profit comes up to $410.
Cool.
Very good.
Yeah, this is a...
So, would you custom
There's definitely
an art, or would you make products that
you sell? You custom made. Custom.
Do you have a design team too, or are you the designer?
Well, I'm thinking of getting a design team, and as well as I could design it as well. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Very cool.
Awesome. That's great.
Excellent job. So next, would you go next, please?
You guys are doing great. Mm-hmm.
Hi, I'm the assistant. And I'm the CEO of Samsung Awesome Sauce. I make a sauce from sweet sauce to hot sauce. It could be used by a mother making a fuss-free meal for her kids to a hearty barbecue with the guys. It is low cost and sodium-free and very nutritious. Our sauce can be designed or custom made for your flavor. It could be any flavor you want, and it is in different portions. And it can be used for any type of celebration or occasion. Sorry. Occasion. say you have a pet and it's, or say you have a pet or you might be allergic to a specific ingredient, it's all ingredient, the ingredients are very, there's very low chance you'll be allergic to any of the ingredients, it's environment friendly, and say your pet might eat it, they won't get sick because it's, it won't harm your dog or your cat. Any questions?
I think, you know, I think one of the things, gift packs.
We have.
That's what I mean. Well, that's just, to me, that's different sauces and things like that. You know, gift packs of those for people, and you can try different things out for the year. Okay. I would like that.
There's a single sauce, and there is a pack of 18 sauces. Mm-hmm. Then there's a bigger jar, then there's a pack of 4 jars, and we also, I'm working on making a plate version.
Awesome.
Are these your recipes?
Yes, sir.
Cool.
And how do you plan on marketing?
Well, I thought I might be able to market to my friends and family from my house and make a stand. Then maybe in a couple of years, I might be able to get a shop, or maybe I could sell my, if I find a shop, I could maybe sell my idea to a company. Maybe.
So you've actually made the product. Have you test marketed it to your friends, family?
Yes. I test marketed it here, and I test marketed it for a couple of weeks, just to my friends, to my family, and they all liked it.
Awesome.
Oh, that's right, it is awesome.
CEO of Game Prodigal.
Game Prodigal is a video game company that creates video games that connect with the audience and also at the same time teach them new rules. So this is why our games are different than the usual games out there.
Our main consumers are, or targeters are basically in the ages of like 6 to 18. And basically, basically like us, they have a passion. They probably have a passion for games, video games as well.
I decided to go into the gaming industry because ever since I was little, my brother and I have had our own passion for gaming. And we decided we want to make our own contribution to the gaming industry. And for this reason, this led to Game Prodigal. And I've obtained the software to program these games. It's called Unity, and it's free. And to put even one of our apps on the App Store, it would cost us about $99. And to advertise it throughout the App Store, it would cost about $200. And to advertise it throughout other apps and games, it would cost another $200. And finally, we would need a modification just to make the process a little bit easier to program these games. So that would cost us about $100. So together, all this would cost us about $600 to $700 to start Game Prodigal. And we are planning on getting our money from the investor bank. And for these reasons, we asked them to fund us about $700 so that we may be the next big entrepreneurs, and so that we will spark the imaginations of gamers and take gaming to a whole new level.
Yes. How would you price your games?
Price about $390.
Have you developed games already?
No, we haven't uploaded any games yet.
Yes, in that process.
Awesome.
excellent presentation, gentlemen. Thank you so much.
talked about where you're going to sell your product. What were some of your ideas in terms of marketing it out?
I would sell my EMS to party planners or local stores who would be willing to share the store with me, and I can just sell the take EMS every week, and if they request a certain EMS, I can make that and I can sell it to them.
So your family has been making pinatas for a while, and they're making them and selling them. So is this a new product then to add to that line of pinatas? How is it different than what we have been making in the past?
Well, when my grandpa started, they weren't as strong, but over the years they've made pinatas stronger. So if you go to, like, we always have our pinatas at family parties, and there's like, we have a lot of kids in our family, and they usually get hit about 2 or 3 times, including the kids my age. They get to hit 2 or 3 times, so that's the strength of it.
And are you planning on expanding the market?
Yes.
Selling more than you have.
People that have a sweet tooth and party planners and wedding planners. Also, the community I will be serving is Latour County.
Your recipes?
Huh?
Are they your recipes?
Yeah, they're handcrafted.
And how about shapes? Do you have forms for them, or do you just do
it? Yeah, like different kinds of shapes, like characters, like any kind of characters.
Do you have molds to make those?
No, they're handcrafted.
So you make each one individually, is that it?
Yeah.
Cool. What do they run the price wise?
Excuse me? Can you repeat it?
Have you developed a price for
them? Yeah, $2.
That's reasonable.
Yeah, because the cost was 80 cents and I was selling it for $1. Because I saw it at school or like family parties, but the cost came out to 80 cents, but I wasn't earning anything, so I had to put the price up.
Yeah.
So which was $2.
How do you wrap them?
It's chocolate. It's a.
But you put a package on it?
No, it's melted chocolate.
Uh-huh.
And then we dip the cake pop inside, and then they get covered. And then after that, well, depending on like what kind of cake pop it is, like if it's a shape, well, that's something different. But if it's just a regular cake pop, you just dip it inside the melted chocolate, and then you put sprinkles, and then it gets harder.
Do you have examples?
We have had the samples though here in class, and they're really, really good. You have other products cake pops are your specialty, but please share your other products.
Well, not only would I be selling cake pops, also would I also be selling chocolate covered strawberries, fruit arrangements, chocolate covered pretzels, apples covered in tamarindo, and etc.
Whose kitchen do you use?
My mom's.
For right now.
Yeah.
He's just already had so many experiences already. This is something he's been doing for a while and has made some money, so he sees it as something he can really expand. So
you've already test marketed to your peers and family?
Yeah, I used to sell at school, and I sell at family parties.
Very cool.
Excellent presentation. Thank you.
sociolinguistics, which is learning a language to learn about people who speak a language and their culture. And our name, our company name is Dear Pen Pal. And what we are is a matching service that we match you up with a pen pal. And we have custom services and we will match you to anyone you want. Like, you can set standards. You will fill out a questionnaire and then you will be able to pick somebody. If you want someone to be a certain age or be from a certain place or your gender or another gender or whatever you want. And we'll help you match you up with the perfect pen pal.
So basically what a pen pal is a person that you write to that's mostly from, generally always be from a different country. It could be from the same country, but generally it's always from a different country. And you'll speak about things like daily life, their language, their culture, to learn more about themselves. And the general way that you have a pen pal is by snail mail, which is you write letters to them. And some people actually prefer that way because they like having the package, like opening it and having it in their hand and knowing that they're talking to someone from a different country.
What makes us unique from other companies that do this is that we will have you log on or create an account and become a pal, and then you will be able to fill out the questionnaire and have your customized pen pal search, and that we are snail mail. We have you just connect you with the person and then you gotta write to them the traditional way. And it's free. So we don't charge anything.
And my experience is that I actually had a pen pal when I was in elementary school in third grade, and it was a boy from Great Britain. And it was really fun just getting like a letter each week and knowing that you knew someone from a different country. And we would just talk about basic things like, oh, how was their day and things like that. And yeah, it was a really fun experience for me.
And our target market is going to be people in the Ventura County area from the ages 13 to 25, because those people are more likely going to be wanting to connect with people overseas and around the world.
And the uses for this service are learning about language, connecting people, maybe international students that want to learn the language from other students, or maybe business people that want to get an insight of the country before they go there, and also just people that just want to connect with
people. Our slogan is, whether across the world or overseas, Dear Pen Pal is here, please. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very cool. How did the two of you work together to come up with your business ideas and business plan?
I originally had a different idea, but trial and error had a failure. So I ended up working with her. This was really good.
So I missed how you make, how you make money at this. You said the service is free?
It's with sponsors.
Ah, okay. So you sell sponsorship?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yes.
And then is the application done by internet or?
It's a website.
When you hook people up, it's not, you don't hook up the email addresses, it's
no,
a regular street address.
Yeah.
Unless they want to show that in the lab.
Yeah.
Very cool.
That's a great idea.
Very good job. Thank you. And Angeles, would you please be our last presenter?
Hi, my name is Angeles Montero. I'm the CEO of Apathetica. And I've been playing soccer for 2 years now, and this is the reason why I started this company, because I have a knowledge of what's required for women, the equipment required for women between the age of 15 and 25. And by my personal experience being in the sport, the most expensive items are the equipment. So I want to provide women with affordable equipment for them to practice and play in. I feel pleased with the price.
How are you
going to
sell your product?
I want to sell my product, like, get like a big quantity and sell them to teams, personally my team, to start with my team, and tell them and as expand as the world, how it goes.
So soccer equipment for women.
So soccer equipment for women on a... Are you like the high school level, collegiate level?
Yeah, age of 15 and 25.
Okay, so it's going to be like the under 18 group and then on up into collegiate type thing, Division 2, Division 1.
Yes.
How long have you been working on your business?
Well, I'm
research was that there was a lot of teams that are throughout the Oxnard area. There were many, many teams, not just associated with schools. Mm-hmm. And Angeles is very familiar with that, so she already has a market area that she wants to go after.
You also have the OSA, other one, good club soccer.
Yes.
Any
questions? Ambitious plans. Oh, yeah. Very, very good. Thank you, Angela. As you have noticed, many of the projects that our students have started off with trial and error, but they're all very passionate about the ideas they have and often have experiences. We are coming towards the end of our time, but I did want to ask a couple questions to end with. But what questions do you have? Is there any question that you'd like to ask our speakers?
Throughout your more professional careers, do you believe that when you get rejected, you were able to handle it better rather than when you first started?
No.
That's a very good question.
That's an excellent question.
Well, yeah, when it happens.
Yeah, I think you get more thick skin as you experience it more and more. And a lot of times it's not rejection of you. It's a rejection. Well, this is my business. It's rejection of your position, and so you don't take it personally. You understand that if you're advocating one point, there may be other people who have an entirely different point of view, and they're not gonna accept your ideas.
Well, it's you. As time goes on, you become more aware of who you are. In your confidence level, and you know, but not everybody's going to like it. You can't do anything about the answer as long as it's truthful. I mean, if you give somebody, always tell the truth, and you never have to change your story. It's always the same way. And not everybody gets that. You know, they feel really bad about it. They're just kind of, well, how could I have done that differently or whatever? And say, you know, and as time goes on, it's just it is what it is. You know, it's just you can't change what it is. So it's just helping people. But it's with what you do is you get more experience, is that maybe you're able to deliver that message in a nice way instead of really abrupt. You know, you learn how to polish your delivery a little bit.
And you lose every situation as a learning experience. And take the information that's being provided and, you know, process that through your mind and see how, you know, your delivery could be phased a little different so the people that you're speaking to can better understand where you're coming from, but then by the same token be able to change and be adaptable to change whenever necessary.
What I'd like to do, I have three more questions, but time is running short. I wonder if each one of you, as I ask a question, just one of you could respond to it so we have a little more information. One of the things that we have been diligently working on is looking at that first budget and first spending, that first year when you're in business. And I'm wondering if any one of you would like to answer and give us some insight on what are some of the first considerations that you should think about in spending and in budget that first year of a business.
I'll take that one because that really hits my business because it was multifaceted and an awful lot of cost went into it. Research. Get trends history on, you know, whatever the products and raw materials and things like that that you're going to be using. Get some history on that so you can anticipate, you know, price increases over time. That's extremely important. And whatever you come up with a budget, add 25% to that, and that's probably going to get you a little more closer to what reality is going to be over time. You know, remember, doing business, you have your materials, your labor, your building costs, you have insurance, advertising, promotion, you have hardware, software needs within your business, your insurance costs. All of those things have to be taken into consideration. Do you have the legal right to sell or perform the service or product that you're promoting?
Make sure you have that. Somebody mentioned getting a copyright or a patent on that product. Make sure that you have all of those things in place and contact the right people to help you in that regard if you don't have a contact already. There's always the unexpected that hits you, and make sure you have enough capital to be able to carry yourself for the first 5 years. Because if you don't, you're going to be looking for money outside, and money is very difficult these days, you know, to get from a banking standpoint. So prepare yourself.
So maybe 25% over what you originally budgeted?
Over what they
originally
thought that the rush was going to be.
And don't spend everything when you first get your first paycheck, right?
What's that?
Don't spend your first paycheck.
Absolutely not.
So thank you for that. And then maybe one of you can answer our second question is, how important is reputation to a business person, a professional, or an entrepreneur? We kind of know the answer, but we'd like to hear yours.
Absolutely vital. I answer this and say it's a vital element of anything we do. You are your work. You are, you know, and you usually only get one chance. So somebody comes to you and your reputation, you build a reputation and then the community will refer people to you based on your reputation or not. So it depends on their experience with you. So every person you come in contact with is vital that you, if you don't know something, it's okay to say, I don't really know, let me find out. Don't make something up. You'll sink yourself. Don't ever compromise your ideals. Ever. You know, you're going to do it once, and you're going to wake up. You won't sleep at night. So you have to be able to look at yourself in the mirror the next morning and know, I did a good job. I handled it correctly. Or if you didn't handle it correctly, how could you do it different? If you goofed, get a hold of the person and say, you know what, I made a mistake. Be honest about it. Don't let it settle. It's really important. You will make mistakes. And it happens. But that's part of your reputation. So you're honest, you're forthright, and if there's anything you can do to rectify whatever it is that happened, then you do it.
So reputation is hard won, but easily lost, so you have to treat it with a lot of respect.
Very much so, yeah.
Excellent. And then our last question, Mark, you've got it. We are so proud of the support we get from the Chamber of Commerce, but we'd like to hear from you why you think being a member of the Chamber of Commerce is important.
Well, first and foremost, it is one of the few organizations that is a business organization here to support small business. And that's what it is. It's advocacy, it's networking, it's sharing information, it's education, and in this community, like take a look at the Oxnard community, in this city, the one organization that does that for business, and especially small businesses, is the Chamber of Oxnard, Chamber of Commerce in this case. I have been a member of the board of the Oxnard Chamber of Commerce since 1972. Continuously. And I don't regret a minute of it. I think it's been valuable to my career. I think it's helped my reputation. And certainly it's helped my familiarity with the community, which is a big advantage when you're doing business in the community. I did an endorsement for the Chamber paper last year, and we were all asked to do that. And I said, and I still believe, that probably the most important single investment that I've made in my career is my membership in the Absolute Writers. So that's what I think.
Wow, that's excellent. So when we're talking about the Chamber of Commerce, which we've talked about several times, I think it's important that you give back to your community. I mean, you're in business, you give back to your business community, and for me, I think it's always a win-win situation. It can help people in the next generation to keep business community healthy. So again, we're very grateful to the chamber. Do you have any last questions that you would like to ask? Everybody has been so fabulous this evening. Would you like to ask anything else before we close, gentlemen? All right, last comment?
No, I really appreciate the opportunity to participate. I had no idea what the Young Entrepreneurs Academy is until this evening, and I'm really very proud of these people that I see and what they're doing. So thank you very much.
Yeah. You know, and just, you know, when you look at young people in the community, you always hear the bad things about young people. But when you get an opportunity to meet young people like we have before us today, it really warms your heart to know that, you know, we're going in the right direction, and you guys are going to be the pillars of our community, and you're going to be our leaders, and it's going to be up to you to make the decisions that hopefully lead us in a better path than some of us have made in the past. And I really commend all of you for, you know, your efforts and your sincerity and your enthusiasm for what you're doing. It's really refreshing to see. Thank you.
Yeah, just we enjoyed listening to your business and your idea for your business, kind of your mission vision type of a thing, and that's vital to it. And it's just you keep that vision there, and as you grow, it doesn't mean you can't tweak it or change it a little bit, you know. And I think we've talked about it. Change is constant, so be adaptable to change. Control the controllables. You know, don't try to control everything. Control what you can control, and persevere. And it looks like you guys are doing it. And so my hat goes off to you. I just think it's really awesome that you guys are part of this group, and we couldn't be happier for you.
And in closing, I'd like to say a big part of our success is also the support we get from our parents. And so, Dr. Fussell, you're representing our parents tonight. They make sure their students are with us and just really are incredible in this endeavor. We thank you for all you do for our community, both in your business and all of you are involved in community efforts beyond your business. So thank you for that. Bob, we thank you for being here. You did an awesome job. Let's give everybody a hand. And